The families of victims from the Orlando nightclub shooting are suing some big tech companies, accusing Twitter, Facebook and Google of providing material support to ISIS. For more on this, internet security analyst Hemu Nigam and criminal defense attorney Brian Claypool. Thank you both for being here. Let's look at the legal hurdles here first, Brian. The Communications Decency Act essentially shields computer services from liability for content. So how does that work? And that's a pretty big hill to climb in this case, right?
Well, I would like to say it's insurmountable. I mean, when I first heard about a lawsuit being filed as a result of the Orlando nightclub shooting, I thought that these families were going to be suing maybe law enforcement for not going in more quickly to shoot at Omar Mateen, or possibly even the gun shop owner, or even possibly the FBI for not investigating. When I heard that they were suing internet companies, I thought of one thing, the Titanic, because these cases are sinking fast.
Okay. But this law essentially gives a free pass to social media, social media sites.
There was a law enacted, a federal law in the United States enacted in 1996 to make it easy for you and the viewers. Basically, it says if somebody else posts information on the internet, the internet provider is not responsible for that data, and they cannot be sued and be held civilly liable for that. One exception is where there's federal criminal activity, and I think that's what these families are trying to do here. They're trying to say that the internet providers were materially supporting ISIS.
And with that, this is the twist in the case, because the lawsuit is arguing by matching user content with targeted advertising, somehow the social media site is providing its own novel content. So, Hamid, explain the technical aspects.
Yeah, and I have to first say, all our hearts go out to the families. We all feel that way, but that doesn't mean a lawsuit's going to solve that problem. And I think what Google is actually taking the lead on this. What they're doing is they're saying, look, if you are looking for ISIS content, maybe you're somebody who might get recruited. There's advertising that comes up that takes you to places that you can get help, or at least even, for example, see content of what happens when ISIS attacks, such as what happened in the Berlin Christmas incident just 2 days ago or yesterday. So Google is doing that. Twitter is actually doing a lot of things, and the companies are getting together and saying, we're going to band forces and try to solve this problem, not by ourselves, but together and working with law enforcement.
But right now the families are saying that those searches, be it on Google or Facebook, whatever, is what is essentially bringing all of this together, which it seems to be a novel legal approach, Brian.
Yeah, I mean, the only way I think these families can prevail in this case is if they've got some information, for example, that Twitter or Facebook was aware of some really nefarious postings that might incite terrorism, and then they didn't do anything to remove those, because then you're possibly facilitating this. You're on notice. Bear in mind, these internet providers don't have a duty to canvass the internet to find these postings.
Okay, with that in mind, this lawsuit is also alleging that the tech companies should not do enough to shut down jihadist groups. They use this example of an ISIS-linked Twitter account. This is part of the suit. When its account at TurMedia333 was shut down, it started at TurMedia334. When that was shut down, it started at TurMedia335. This naming convention, adding one digit to a new account after the last one is suspended, does not seem as if it would require artificial intelligence to spot. Each of the accounts also use the same user photograph of a bearded man's face over and over and over again. So, Hemu, from a technical point of view, would it be easy for Twitter to simply stop these accounts from springing up over and over again?
Here's a reality. First, let's give kudos to Twitter for deleting 360,000 accounts in the first place, knowing that these ISIS folks are going to try to come back and create new accounts and do kind of a cat and mouse game. But that said, there's a new initiative happening right now between Google, Microsoft, and Twitter, where they're going to be fingerprinting indicia of an ISIS account and then using it by sharing it amongst themselves in a database and saying, here's a new account coming up. It looks very much like this, has the fingerprints of these other accounts, and I think you're going to see those accounts even disappearing.
So just to be very clear, is there a legal responsibility here for these companies, not just to sort of mow the weeds, but to pull the roots as well?
That's exactly right. I mean, if they're notified of some of these accounts that might be inciting mass terrorism, then they have a duty to remove those accounts. But John, really, I think the point that I'm troubled with here is this really the cause of a guy like Omar Mateen going into a nightclub and shooting up people? I think people in the United States need to be paying attention more to red flags. Right. I mean, he went out and got a gun at a place where he shouldn't have gotten a gun. So I think that, to me, is the bigger issue.
Okay, but hey, just because Omar Martin may have seen these videos of this jihadi content online, doesn't actually mean he was influenced by it, does it?
No, not at all. Exactly. He could be talking to 10,000 other people in off settings. A lot of times what ISIS recruiters do is they may target one individual and then immediately go into an app conversation, a cell phone conversation, all these other kinds of things they're doing. So this is one of those where making the causal connection is never going to happen.
That's exactly
and,
right.
And I think at the end of the day, what I think the world needs to know is you got lawyers here who are filing lawsuits giving false hope to families who have already been tragically hurt, and now they're going to say, wait a minute, nothing's going to happen. Well, that's because you went down the wrong path.
Do you think it's false hope?
I think it is false hope. You guys just hit the nail on the head. You've got to prove causation. Yeah. Was this a substantial factor in causing Omar Mateen to do what he did? Okay. I doubt it.
Guys, thanks so much. Appreciate you being with us.
Thanks, John.